So thank you, Kevin, for the introduction. For more than 100 years, the British cycling representation won only one Olympic medal, and none of British riders won the famous Tour de France race. The team was so bad that actually one of the cycling manufacturers refused to sell them a bike for fear of a negative image. But in 2003, the British Cycling Organization hired a new coach, Dave Braceford, and that changed everything. In the next Olympics in Beijing, the British triumphed. And 5 years later, in the Olympics in London in 2008, they set 9 cycling Olympic records and 7 world cycling records, which was unbelievable. So what happened? What did Dave Braceford do that none of the previous coaches could have done for more than 100 years? The strategy was simple. He introduced small improvements in all areas that could affect the results. Better saddles, heating in cycling clothes to keep the muscles warm, biofeedback during training, better diet, mental coaches, even a surgeon who taught riders how to wash correctly their hands. Absolutely every area was improved by a small amount, which led to success. So how successful are clinical trials? A group of scientists from MIT analyzed a huge data set of drugs and vaccines from 2000 to 2015 to estimate rates of moving to the next phase of clinical trial and to have the final approval of a drug. So they found out that the overall probability of success to have the acceptance of a drug is around 14%. This value changed between different therapeutic areas and was biased by a significantly low rate in oncology, which you can see in this table. So the overall probability of success is not as bad as the British cycling team for 100 years, but I don't think we can say that we are already a gold medalist. And there are many areas that we can improve to increase this probability of success. And in this presentation, I would like to show you one of these areas that impact the final success and of course, how to improve it. So imagine that you are working on a monoclonal antibody that was developed as an immunotherapy against rheumatoid arthritis. It is known that imbalance of certain receptor ligand signaling pathways is crucial in development of inflammation. So to prevent it, you develop this monoclonal antibody in such a way that it binds to a soluble and membrane bound receptors and as a result blocks the inflammatory cascade. The phase 1 clinical trial was performed with a single dose at different dose levels on healthy individuals and patients with rheumatoid arthritis. And it was established that doses up to 30 milligrams per kilogram or 2000 milligrams are safe. And in addition, the data from this phase 1 allowed to develop a model which describes PK and PD dynamics. In particular, it describes the drug, which is here monoclonal antibody, soluble receptor and membrane bound receptor. And these two receptors are produced and eliminated with different rates. In addition, measurements from this phase 1 clinical trial of three drug and total soluble receptor allowed to estimate the model parameters with quite a good accuracy in monoliths. So here we have a VPC plot for the total soluble receptor in patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So now the next step is to use this information to design phase dosing regimens of the phase two, which will study the efficacy of a multi-dose regimen on the inhibition of receptor. More precisely, let's assume that there is some evidence that more than 90% inhibition of a membrane-bound receptor relative to baseline is a reliable predictor of clinical accuracy. So phase two is intended to be exploratory phase. However, its results will define if a drug is significantly promising to justify phase three. So designing or planning dosing regimens means answering different questions, considering different scenarios, taking into account uncertainty, and it's like a race with the finish line being the most successful dosing regimen. And let me show you that Simulix is actually the fastest bike you can have that takes you to this final line. First acceleration is the easiness to create simulation in Simulix from a monolith project. So a model, estimated parameters, and cover rates from your data set can be directly exported from monolith to Simulix. And there you just define new values. So in this case, it will be a new variable which describes the membrane-bound receptor relative to baseline, new treatment element for the multi-dose regimen, new output to cover a longer observation period, and new cover rates to simulate a different population. So let me show you. Here I have the Monolix project with a structural model as I presented in the slides, and statistical model with effect of weight on the volume of distribution and effect of disease on the baseline of the receptor. In the results sub, I have estimated population parameters and individual parameters. So now with one click in the top menu, I export all this information to Simulix. And here, automatically, several different elements are defined. So for instance, model is imported as an MLX transformatted code. I have population parameters and individual parameters estimated by monolix as tables and vectors. And I have cover rates, treatment, and output that are defined using information from the dataset. So in a few seconds, I have everything ready to start working on my phase two clinical trial. However, in the phase one clinical trial, the measurements were only of the soluble receptor, and my efficacy that I want to test in the phase two is based on the inhibition of the membrane-bound receptor. So the first question would be, what are the inhibition levels for different dosing regimens? And to answer this question, I can use exploration function in Simulix, which simulates a typical individual and allows me to explore interactively different treatment parameters or model parameters. So in this case, I fix my treatment period to 6 months, and by changing the amount and the interdose interval, I can find out very easily what is the amount of a dose that gives me 90% inhibition. And I find out that a dose of 1,500 milligrams administered once every 4 weeks or 1,000 milligrams each 2 weeks gives me the desired efficacy level of the inhibition of the membrane-bound receptor. So this rapid selection of a promising doses regimen will save me a lot of time in the next step where I'm going to simulate population of patients. And because in the phase one, we used a weight-based dosing, which is also very common for monoclonal antibodies, I'm going to test 3 dosing regimens, not 30, and it will be 20, 25, and 30 milligrams per kilogram administered once per month, and they span more or less doses between 1,400 milligrams and 2,100. So here I have a project where I already defined those 3 different different dosing regimens, which have 6 doses every 28 days. So we have 4 weeks with different amounts, 20, 25, or 30, which is multiplied by weight. So this is obtained with the scale amount by cover weight. Now to build a simulation scenario, I create 3 groups and use a treatment as a group specific. And now for each group, I select different dosing regimen. Now for the output, instead of using the observation times from the data set, I'm going to use a new output that I defined, which is inhibition of the membrane-bound receptor related to baseline during 6 months. And instead of population that was in the first data set of the phase one, I use a new cover weight, which has only patients with rheumatoid arthritis. So I have probability 1 for this modality with weight distributed around 70 kilograms with 20% of variation. Now, as I'm interested in the difference or in the effect only due to the treatment or to the different dosing regimens, not to the variability between individuals, I will select a large number of individuals in each group and an option, same individuals among group. So each group will have exactly the same parameters. So this is kind of a crossover study. Now running the button here simulation, I will run the scenario and the plots and results are automatically generated, which gives me immediate information that actually the dosing regimens of 25 and 30 milligrams per kilogram once per month looks promising, as they have the inhibition at the end of the treatment below this red line, which corresponds to this efficacy target of 90%. However, to have a complete picture of the situation, I need to quantify these results, taking into account this efficacy target. So actually I need to check for each individual if he or she reaches the efficacy target. And this is also very easy and really rapid in Simulix because it has built-in post-processing functions that allows to calculate most common outcomes or post-processing of your outputs. So in this case, I'm using the value of the inhibition of the membrane-bound receptor relative to baseline at the end of the treatment, and I select a threshold to be below 0.1, which exactly corresponds to the 90% inhibition. Now the outcome in Simulix will be calculated for each individual, and in plots of outcome distribution, I can see for each group what is the actual number of individuals in among these 500 in the group who satisfy this condition. And the endpoints just summarize this computation and give me the percentage of true individuals, percentage true So percentage of individuals who are in the, who reach the target of efficacy of 90% inhibition. These results were obtained assuming that my model is correct. So my model parameters are correct in the sense that Simulix simulated individual parameters using one population with one set of population parameters, theta pop. However, what if the parameters are estimated with some uncertainty? This will impact the values of my endpoint. So in Simulix, actually, you can check it with a click because you can simulate, you can replicate your simulation scenario and use different set of population parameters for each replicate. So in this simulation, I have exactly as before, three groups with different dosing regimens, but now instead of single simulation, I'm going to use replicates. Let's say I'm going to simulate the same scenario 100 times. But now instead of one set of population parameters, which come from monoliths, so these are values estimated in my monoliths project, I'm going to use a different parameter element, which is a table. Let me show it right here. So this is a table with 100 sets of population parameters. Actually, this table I obtained with RSpeak Simulix package, which allows me to sample population parameters from a probability distribution with standard deviation given by standard errors estimated by monoliths. So now if I select new parameter element, I am now set, everything is set to run the simulation. And in the endpoint distribution plot, I can now have the information not only of the median value of the percentage in the target, but also of the uncertainty of this value due to the uncertainty of population parameters. So here we can see that actually dosing of 30 milligrams per kilogram administered once every 28 days could guarantee that more than 90% inhibition of membrane bound receptor for 9 in 10 individuals, which is a quite good result. However, when we plan or design a phase 2 and select a dosing regimen, there are much more what if questions to be answered. For instance, what if the distribution of weight in the population is different? Here I just selected value of 70 as a typical value and 20% variability. Or what if patients have renal impairment, which can reduce the clearance? Or what if we start with a loading dose? All of these questions are important and in selecting the best dosing regimens to justify the phase 3 or not. And Simulix will just get you faster to this final line of this best dosing regimen. Thank you.
We have a number of attendees here. Folks, if you have questions, my suggestion is that you type them in the window. There's a chat window that should be in your Excel events place and or in the Q&A tab, and I'd be looking at either place. While we're waiting for folks to have their questions, I am curious, you talked a lot about population simulations, that is, the notion of taking a population based on the model and simulating many individuals to get an idea about what the true response to the drug might be. I was wondering if you could comment on how to use Simulx in a trial simulation mode. So when we have a particular trial design and we're trying to understand what the probability of success for that trial might be.
Yes, so actually there are different options. In this case, it was really just comparing different dosing regimens. But now if you, instead of, for example, model predictions, you will use model observations. So prediction plus the error, which comes from measurements. Now we are closer to simulating a clinical trial. And then with, again, you can post-process the outcome to calculate the number of individuals that satisfy some your target or your definition of your success. And in addition, there are statistical tests that actually compare different and actually allow to calculate probability of success for different dosing, different designs of a clinical trial.
So you can perform the actual statistical tests for, say, significance in a particular given trial.
Yes, and actually, this will be a talk of Claude Magnard tomorrow. So she will exactly explain the second, so design of a clinical trial, so phase three based on data from phase two.
Okay. Excellent. One other question, and I asked this maybe not knowing whether it's possible or not. Is it possible to simulate adaptive dosing in your platform? So the idea where, patients are enrolled in the study and they come in and they have perhaps a suboptimal response at that particular time that's observed, and then be able to adjust the dose on that basis.
So it's not possible directly in the interface. However, each function or each action that you do in interface is, we have an R function to do that. So you can write your script with different steps with the line that says you if the concentration is crossed Cmax that you define, then change the dose and redo it. Actually, we have already an example of that with dose individualization. And of course, this is possible not in the interface, but with the R functions using the interface. So, yeah.
Excellent. That's a very flexible tool and a platform.
Yes.
Are there any other questions that folks might have? We have a pretty large number of participants, which I'm excited to see. I'm wondering if, I think you can each unmute yourself if you'd like to ask a question. Oh, Aruna has raised her hand. Go ahead.
Hi, this is Aruna Dantabhutani from Pharma Pro Consulting. My question is with regards to, I understand that one can actually simulate the data. This comes out of Molinix, right? Is it also possible? Is it compatible with non-MAM? How about Phoenix? Can you comment a little bit about that, please?
So in this example, I used I built a Simulx simulation scenario using a Monolix project where I used a model and, for example, cover rates from dataset. So now if I can, by default, when you use this export to Simulx, everything is set to resimulate Monolix project. However, the results, even if similar, are not exactly the same as in your dataset because there are different random effects that are sampled. So this is not exactly the sampling in Simulx. It's not exactly the same to obtain your dataset. The difference with all other software is that, and this is what I tried to show you in the presentation, that actually the whole process is really, really fast. So with few clicks in the interface, you're actually simulating different groups with different number of individuals, with different population, or with different population parameters, and everything in 10 minutes which gives you a lot of time to think about new possible questions or new possible scenarios to test. And this is the main difference in the between different softwares.
Maybe just one last comment slash question from me. It's good to be the moderator, and then we'll have to move on to Yogesh's talk. And my question was with respect to inputting non-mem data sets. So I think one quite, you know, frequently people have access to a non-mem or, you know, perhaps FEMA data that's formatted for Phoenix. Is it possible to import that into Monolix and Simulix for this?
So there are two methods to build a simulation in Simulix. So interconnection with Monolix is useful for people who use Monolix Suite, but Simulix is an independent application. So it is not necessary to use a Monolix project. Actually, one of our webinars in December presented exactly how to create a simulation in Simulix from scratch. So you just write your model, you define all elements, and then you are simulating whatever you want. So there is this interconnection with Monolix is useful, but it can work independently on a model that you designed in non-mem or any other software.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. That was a really interesting talk.